All types of industries are today under pressure to reduce weight, cost and size of their products. But at the same time, the products are expected to perform better and longer. We are in a steel age, so even though steel is likely to remain a fundamental part of the industry for years to come, other materials are being actively researched and developed to complement steel. Polymers, aka plastics, ceramics, composites and other metals, what part will they play in the future? And in which applications do they work best? And how will these new materials affect product development and the product life cycle of manufacturing? Let's get some answers. Let's talk. We're joined by Professor Sir Harry Bhadeshia, Tata Steel Professor at Metallurgy here at Cambridge. And then we have from Rolls-Royce, Martin Rawson, an engineering specialist in the field of steel. And to my right, I have Steve Lane, Manager of Metallic Materials and Ceramics Department at SKF's Engineering and Research Center in the Netherlands. And last but not least, Professor Theo Dingemans, who just recently left his post at the Faculty of Aerospace Engineering at Delft University in the Netherlands. And you're now at the University of North Carolina in the Department of Applied Physical Sciences. So welcome, gentlemen. Steve, I think I'll start with you. I mean, today's Let's Talk is all about future materials, but I think it would be interesting to also start to talk about one of our most commonly used materials, steel. Has steel played out its role today?
We're currently using something like 1.7 billion tons of steel worldwide, and that will grow to something like 2.8 in 2050. Mm-hmm. So steel is growing, certainly. There is a dilemma for the steel industry, however. One area is certainly sustainability. The emissions and the energy usage in producing steel have to be brought down to lower levels. At present, to take or produce a one-ton melt of steel, it takes typically, or it emits, 1.8 tons of CO2. Mm. These are issues that need to be addressed. One route is certainly to take more recycled scrap, because the recycling process is more efficient in terms of energy usage and also the emissions. So that is one area to focus on more. The problem is, at present, there is a shortage of scrap somewhat, and we're faced with the issue that when we do use recycled steel, there is problems with contamination.
Turning over to you, Martin, coming from the aerospace industry, how would you say steel's role has changed today?
Okay. I can explain that using this diagram here, which shows a typical section of a gas turbine engine. In the past, in the 1970s, you would have seen some steel in these rotors here. These sections here we call the rotors. So that's which actually hold the blades, so the blades sit outside of the rotor. So we would have seen more steel in this part of the engine. But now, today, the steel is focused very much, as you can see on the diagram there, in the core of the engine, which is the transmission sections. And therefore, the challenge, really, for steel in these parts of the engine, for things like mainline shafts, for the bearings, and also for gears, is to actually increase the fatigue performance, and therefore do as much as we can to reduce the weight in the core of the engine.
What is new in steel research today from an academia perspective?
Yes, so basically the fundamental property of metals is that there's a metallic bond. And this means that if you displace an atom, even over long distances, you do not leave behind a structure which is broken. Okay, so that metallic bond means that metals are extremely defect tolerant, and the particular aspect of iron, which makes it even more interesting, is that there are a lot of phase changes, and those phase changes can be modified by adding anything in the periodic table. Mm-hmm. So you have a virtually infinite variety of structures that you can produce in order to get a combination of properties that might be useful. So there's an awful lot to be done, and because we have such a huge amount of knowledge on steels, given a problem, we can actually design things by mathematical modeling and experimental validation to meet a whole range of properties together. So steels are extremely defect tolerant. If you look at things like carbon nanotubes, you introduce defects, they basically lose their strength immediately.
But there's also a need for alternative materials. I mean, one reason is obviously weight reduction. So turning to you, Theo, why else does industry need new materials?
You mentioned weight saving. In the context of steel, that is, of course, composites are a major development. I mean, you see companies such as Airbus and Boeing moving toward carbon composite airplanes to save weight. But quite often you also have to go to different materials because of legislation. I mean, sometimes you're not allowed to use a certain material, so you need to move to something else. Mm. On the drawing that we just saw on the jet engine, in the front part where it's not so hot, you can start using composites. So what we try to do is come up with materials that have a structural ability, but also a functional ability. If you look at polymers, you got to think about a density of around 1-2 grams per cubic centimeter. And we want to bring function to it. So you got to think about polymers that can be used as shape memory. So you can have something that at a high temperature changes shape, allows air to come in or water to come in and changes back. We're thinking about materials that can actually add as a structural material and as a solar cell, so it can generate energy. We're thinking about polymers that can be used in structural applications where they can also function as a battery, as a membrane, you name it.
From a bearing standpoint, I mean, we've noticed that the bearings have to withstand more adverse conditions of light. I mean, we're talking about downsizing of products, so the higher loads they have to go to. The example shown by Martin for the high extreme temperatures, we need more temperature resistance, corrosion resistance. And in some cases, steel just cannot do the job. And particularly on the weight side, we have light alloys, of course, traditional materials with aluminium, titanium and magnesium type alloys. But these type of materials can be used in other ways, in hybrid sort of designs where we actually mold or cast the aluminium around maybe a steel ring insert. Instead of making a large hub bearing unit from all of steel, we could think about producing the whole flange component from aluminium and the raceway itself for the bearing from a steel insert. So that's one way of reducing weight. And that's one approach that we're following at the moment. But there are other materials, of course, one which has been very successful is use of ceramics in hybrid bearings, for example. And the ceramics, structural ceramics, have a lot of potential, of course, for reducing weight. They have high elastic modulus, so it's much stiffer material. It's electrically insulating. It has some lubricity issues as well, which can be beneficial in poor lubrication conditions. And because of that, hybrid bearings are becoming more and more a product on the market. And as the volumes increase, of course, cost goes down, which is an issue. But this certainly has become a very much a success area. And not forgetting, of course, coatings. Coatings give some extra functionality on the steel itself. And there are a lot of developments. We've been using coatings for years for wear resistance with BVD processes, corrosion resistance. But there's some interesting coatings around nowadays, which for reducing friction, for example. Graphene is one that's been mentioned a lot. We don't see it as yet at the moment as an industrial solution. It's very much experimental phase, more for the electronics industry, but it has a low coefficient of friction. It could be something that could be of interest.
Martin, what new materials are Rolls-Royce working at the moment?
Well, there's a full range of materials, really. And yeah, so composites are very much a key part of our future engine technology. You can look at the titanium alloys. There's still research going on in the compressor on titanium materials. So there's advanced titanium materials coming through. You look at the turbine section of the engine, where we've got the advanced super alloys, which have got the temperature capabilities, 700 degrees centigrade plus in the materials. Complement that, or if you've got the development of high temperature nickel blade materials, turbine blades. And one of the things that we're interested there is can you reduce the cost of those materials whilst maintaining the creep performance? So that's another area of research. Then you've got some the use of intermetallics right at the back in the LP turbine section here. The intermetallics are a fantastic material. They've got even lower weight than the titanium themselves, and therefore, as well, you've got the opportunity to reduce the containment requirements. So, and in addition to that, you've got, as we said, you've got hybrid bearings, which we're looking at.
Academia works with two different time frames. Either it's demand and supply, that is demand driven by industry, or there's also innovations that academia actually push technology, but they're sort of like a not existent always parallel to investors and so forth. Could you elaborate a bit more on that?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. So when industry actually has a need, for example, there's an engine program for 20 years ahead for which there isn't a material, then there is extremely good collaboration between industry and universities with any amount of resources that are necessary to reach a certain level of technology readiness. But when something is invented in the university out of a blue skies idea, if you like, and this is one example here, where in the top right hand you see a carbon nanotube, and at the same magnification you see a steel, which has a scale finer than the carbon nanotube. So extremely strong material. Mm. And it has an application, for example, you can buy armor made out of this. But in order to convince industry that they should use this is far more difficult. Mm. Because in order to take it to a point where you find an application, they need to spend much more money than you actually spend in research to get it to a readiness level which is acceptable. So there's a problem. Some ideas that come out of universities are really quite immature in the sense that you can't just talk about strength, but you need to talk about a whole range of properties, including how you might manufacture it. Mm. So if you can't manufacture it, then it's not going to get past your technology readiness level zero.
I was going to say, from a Rolls-Royce perspective, we took the company took the decision sort of probably 30, 40 years ago now, that rather than doing all our research within the company, we would have university technology centres. Mm. And the whole point about a university technology centre such as Cambridge is that you can actually discuss the application, a future application with the university. You can recognise specialist skills within certain universities, such as steels and nickel-based alloy research at Cambridge. And then you can work with that university through that technology centre to develop something which is tailored to the specific requirement of the company. So that was a strategic decision, and that's, I think, worked very well. And other companies, such as SKF, have actually followed that model as well.
Design engineers work from standard databases which are extremely carefully put together because they do not want to make mistakes in designing their components. Okay. So I think Rolls-Royce, NASA, etc., developed a whole series of scales called technology readiness levels, manufacturing readiness levels. Until you get to a certain point, the data are not in their system, so they may not be aware of it. So even within industry, you have people like Martin Rawson here, who are the interface between the engineers and the people in universities. So you need a whole grade of knowledge.
I think 3D printing is one of those examples where you can actually see a development taking place in the university. So some of my colleagues in Chapel Hill started a company called Carbon 3D a couple of years ago, really, in the lab, tinkering with chemistry and tinkering with a 3D printing machine. Mm. 3D printing has been out for a long time, obviously done in metals as well. I'm going to limit myself to polymers. It was an excruciating slow process. I mean, you would melt a layer of polymer and you would put another layer on it, and you would go home at 5 o'clock, and in the morning you would come back and hopefully you had something you could hold. Mm. And so these people changed this whole concept. So they're now monolithically printing structures, and there's actually a movie I think I would like to share that shows how it shows an example of 3D printing of a of an air duct that can be used in automotive. So this is a prototype. Mm. And this somewhat reminds you maybe of the Terminator movie where, at some point, a liquid metal man kind of reassembles himself. And here you see a part being printed that is, so you, the process called CLIP, it stands for continuous liquid interface production. So instead of layer after layer, you just constantly grow a product. And this happens about 400 times faster than any other 3D printing technique. So you can actually now make parts that you can wait for. And we discussed earlier, some of these things just take forever. This goes quite fast. And this is the part. And this is a nice demonstration of it's a prototype that can be used as an air duct. You can make this a lot more complex than with metal. You can actually make a really complicated structure. That's the nice thing about 3D printing of polymers is, complexity is pretty much for free. You can design anything. Computers are nowadays for free. You can design a very complex structure. You can build it. You can print it. You can test it. We can make materials such as these that are very hard. So this is a very stiff material that will function under the hood of a car engine. So it can see some temperature. On the other hand, we can also print very soft materials. So this is an elastomer, as you can see. This is a very soft material. It's an elastomer material. So this will allow you to go into a whole different set of applications. You can now print a part for sneakers, for example, that are specially designed for you because of an orthopedic need. The other thing they can print is, this is a little shock absorber. So it has a hard part and a soft part. So it really brings a lot of the creativity and the design back to the people where it should be, so the designers, the engineers. Mm.
And I know that you call this shift to new technologies a real game changer, primarily for designers. Why is that?
Right, because the same with metals. If you need a metal part, you need to find someone, a producer that can make this for you. If you're a big company like Rolls-Royce, they listen to you. They'll probably make that alloy that you need. With polymers, it used to be the same situation. Polymers would be processed. You buy it from the factory, you get a big bag with granulates, and then you have to injection mold it into a shape. And you have to hope that that's the shape you want. Now you can design it yourself. You can have this machine here on the table, and you can put in a design, and you print it, and you can immediately use it. And you can change it, you can print it, and you can immediately use it. Mm. So it puts a lot more, it takes the processing equation out for the user. You can immediately make what you need.
Some of an alloy like titanium 6-4 has got a very good process window. So it probably is easier to get the mechanical properties in titanium 6-4, for example, using additive layer manufacture or 3D printing. But I think once you get to some of the nickel-based superalloys, Inco 718, for example, it's clear evidence that you just do not achieve the mechanical properties using a 3D printing approach. So I think there's still quite a lot of work to go into that area.
I think that what this now allows you to do, and I don't know exactly how it works for metals, but you're able to print a decent amount of materials relatively fast. If you're, you want to have a custom-made car, mm-hmm. you want to have a car panel that has your name in it. Orthopedics, for example, medical type of applications. That's where these things might become very handy.
Mass customization.
Mass customization, correct. Yep.
This is a question that might be difficult to answer, but I'll throw it out to all of you. Is there research currently going on that the average engineer on new materials, that is, mm-hmm. don't know about? Do you have any secret trades that we could share to the online audience?
I'm obviously not going to give away any secrets, but I think maybe things like thermal barrier coatings, because I'm not quite sure whether people really appreciate what a thermal barrier coating does in a gas turbine engine. But essentially, you've got to realise that the gas temperature would actually melt the material that's used for the turbine blade. It's that hot. So what the thermal barrier coating does is it actually protects, it literally, like a sort of a blanket, it protects the metal of the blade from the gas temperature. So they are very important materials within a gas turbine engine. And as you can appreciate, there's active research in that area, sort of ongoing.
I think it's really hard for engineers to keep up with all the new material developments. I mean, it's there's different aspects, and we kind of touched on it. It's not only developing a new material, it's also the processing. And the processing, that's what really gives materials its unique properties at some point. And it's going to be very hard to you know, to have a good overview on anything that's out there. I think what we've seen the last 20 years is that we're moving more and more towards hybrid materials. Where in the past, you know, where people were trained with wood, metal, maybe polymers, composites are moving in. You see more hybrid type materials interfacing with ceramics. Big challenge where materials come together. What is the maintenance of these materials? How do they fatigue? How do you replace them? How do you repair them? I think there's a lot out there. It's going to be very tough to keep up with everything that's happening. Mm.
Sustainability, carbon footprint. I mean, that, of course, it's such a difficult question to answer here and now. But what's your take on that with new materials, plastics, for example?
Polymers, obviously, is a really big issue. Everyone has seen the images of the what we call the plastic soup. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's tons and tons of plastic floating around in the oceans where it shouldn't be. How does it get there? How do we take it out? And how do we create more responsibility both on the producer and on the users? And legislation can definitely help there as well. There's some throwaway plastic that you can make out of biodegradable type of feedstock, for example. But yeah, it will take time, but it can definitely be done.
We have a similar situation with ceramics as well, of course, because, I mean, it's a very hard material which you cannot decompose as such, and to return it back to a powder product would take a lot of machining, and so we are trying to find ways how to reuse ceramics. I mean, that is one way, instead of recycling the materials, but maybe how to reuse the components somehow in another application, for example.
If we could summarize this all, if you could maybe give me your vision on new materials, let's say 10-year vision. Some might say that 10 years is too much, 5 years is more appropriate. So if I start with you, Harry. Yeah.
So I think I'm looking towards 10 years because one of the issues with steel, which is not flying, is the density. It's 7.89 compared with 1 point something for your polymer. Of course, we can be very clever and we can introduce cellular structures and so forth, but they're not really useful for heavy structural applications. So there is a lot of research going on reducing the density of steels. And, you know, for example, you can find a paper where we have 16% reduction in density. And if you do that, there is no aluminum alloy that can compete with steel. However, these need to be able to be produced on a large enough scale to be useful in applications. So there's a lot of work to go before you start putting these things into application.
For me, in terms of the steels research, I think next 5 to 10 years, really looking for a step change in the fatigue performance of the steels that we use in shafts and bearings and gears. So that for me is probably a sort of a summary of where I'd like to get to.
I mean, sustainability we've talked about a lot, but I think that is going to be very much directing the research in terms of how to reduce energy usage, how to improve the recycling, the life of the component as such. But I think on steel development, I cannot avoid the point by saying it is, I think, an incremental process. And a 5 to 10 year horizon, that is probably realistic 10 years. Because you need time to industrialize a new steel. And it's not always the steel, it's the process involved. Maybe a specific heat treatment. Maybe we need investment. Maybe we need a global supply chain for mass-produced products. And also, very often, a lot of the products that we're using nowadays are performing rather well. Mm. And so these are all things which tend to slow the process down. However, I think there will be a lot of focus on still, as Martin said, improving the fatigue strength of steels. And we've got some fantastic tools now, how we can characterize microstructures. We understand fatigue mechanisms a lot better. We know how to design our structures a lot better, I think. In addition to that, I would say certainly I think light alloys and ceramics will slowly start eating into the steel business somewhat, where it's technically feasible and where it's economical.
But if you look at polymers and composites, I think they're also going to eat away on certain steel applications. We'll do our best. where you definitely, we try to come up with materials that can provide the safety, will be processable. I mean, one of the issues, of course, with carbon fiber is the manufacturing. It's not easy to manufacture carbon structures, and definitely if you look at large-scale structures such as airplanes, even if you look at automotive industry, who's slowly start making steps towards the use of composites. That's ongoing. I think in even in the short term, 5 years, you'll see polymers, for example, these 3D printed capabilities come out and create and add a lot of creativity to designers. They will come out with really fancy new designs. I think that that's going to be very visible in the next 5 years.
The meaning of design is that you actually have a huge number of options. If there is just a single design, it's extremely boring. Mm. Yeah. But let me just say one thing, is that this is not the first time people have tried to predict the future or the demise of one material or another. Watch this space.
Watch this space. Mm. That's a good end wording. Mm. I like that. Watch this. That should have been my wording. I want to thank Professor Theo Dingemans, also Steve Lane, Martin Rawson, and Harry Bhadeshia. And with that, I also hope that you, the audience, that you found this inspirational, relevant, and interesting. And please do share your insights, your questions, your feedback using social media and using our hashtag Let's Talk Future Materials. Because Let's Talk is a knowledge-sharing platform, and it's all about sparking and igniting conversation. So let's do that together. I say bye-bye for this time. Stay tuned for the next edition of Let's Talk.
What are some of the designs that people are thinking about for recycling and sustainability, where you would be able to take them apart very easily and recycle the different materials separately, which is the biggest problem right now?
With polymers, that is definitely a big issue. I mean, packaging materials that you have quite often, like milk cartons, aluminum on the inside, paper, and then plasticized. Okay, you know, that's going to be very hard to recycle. So legislation, there we go again, comes in once in a while with some legislation to fix some of these issues. Automotive has done this themselves, so a lot of the plastics inside of a car are now made out of polypropylene. So it's very easy to recycle this because it's all one material type, so you can really rip it out of the car, recycle it. But for a lot of packaging material with multiple layer, multiple type of materials, that is still a big issue.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of this lies with the customer very often. I mean, for light alloys, there's absolutely no issue regarding recycling. There's no problem, of course, and also for steel as well. So, as I said earlier, ceramics is a concern for SKF, how we can, in the future, reuse these materials. And we are thinking of applications, we're thinking of collecting grinding media, for example, how we can reuse that powder. But as such, It has a lot of work to be done still, I would say. Yeah.
See, with some, you know, really strange. I mean, we're making the first baby steps, I think, in recycling. And one of the issues that you have, I mean, like the nice thing about metal is recycling makes a lot of sense because, you know, if you have a cubic meter, you have a lot of it, right? It's you cannot lift it. You see, in the Netherlands, where I'm from, you see plastic recycling, where we have a big steel container, which we throw in our plastic bottles. And at the end of the day, you have a few cubic meters of air. And you know, then a big truck has to come over of a couple of tons that burns so many liters of fuel to remove maybe 25 or 50 kilograms of plastic. So if you then start looking at the carbon cost, you have to really, you know, place some question marks there. So one of the things that needs to happen is, yeah, can you come up with design? And that's where the designers are again, where you put it in there, you compact it or you grind it, and then you make it granulate, and then these things might become interesting to collect and recycle.
We are looking to refurbishing large-sized bearings, for example, bearings which are 2-3 meters in diameter. And you could imagine such bearings are very, very expensive. We do get them back for refurbishing, for maybe re-lubrication with grease, maybe a new cage to be fitted. That's a lot more cost efficient than supplying a new bearing. But to do that also, we need to know if the material structure is not degraded, it has not decayed, has fatigue already started. And that is a bit of a dilemma for us. I mean, we can monitor how the materials decay with time using X-ray diffraction, but that's a destructive method. And now we're trying to develop a technique, maybe using magnetic field testing, to see if we can detect, yes, this ring is starting to decay. We cannot refurbish it. Let's put a new one there. But we are thinking in that direction, particularly for the large size bearings.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious, in terms of reducing the weight of steel, except from changing the material or like using metal forming kind of manufacturing routes, are there any other potential methods for reducing the weight?
Proper design and manufacture can lead to a weight reduction, but fundamentally, you never have one parameter. You know, so if you reduce the density of steel, the modulus usually goes down as well, the stiffness of the steel, and that might make it unsuitable for a bearing, for example. So there's no simple answer. And, you know, you're a good student, you've asked a difficult question.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's a game of trade-offs, right?
Yeah. We've heard a bit about 3D printing and that kind of new concept of manufacturing routes. Obviously, that's great for design and prototyping and making customized components, but are there any materials or applications where the panel thinks that that kind of bottom-up manufacturing method could become preferable over a traditional casting and machining kind of method in the foreseeable future?
Anything on plastic that can be made in large quantities by injection molding, that can be done at such a high rate, at such a high speed, that you're never going to be able to compete with that with 3D printing.
Okay, and what about things like ceramic components? They're very difficult to machine. Is this kind of...
New net shape forming would be perfect, that's correct. I have no experience at the moment of using this processing route for ceramic materials. I mean, the big issue is with, you're using powder material. You're printing with powder, very fine powders. And the question is the bonding of these powders sufficient to give the right strength for the product? And, okay, in the case of steel, I'm a bit sceptical at the present, but I've heard that they laser fuse such components. So you print and you laser fuse the layer or the surfaces such that you get a good, let's say, adhesion between the powder particles and good strength properties. But it's a bit difficult, I think, with ceramics to do that, of course, due to the high melting point. And ceramics is a difficult material. We use a cold isostatic pressing treatment first, and then we go to very long sintering treatments, hot isostatic pressing as well to densify it at very high temperatures. That's the only way we can ensure that we get the right properties, because I think, as Harry said as well, I mean, these materials are brittle, and... So we have to make sure there's no defects, no pores, anything there. So, and I don't see it being a possibility with 3D printing as such, no. Maybe I'm wrong, but...
certainly for some of the aero engine components are very complex in terms of geometry. But on the same... And then therefore, 3D printing would be a big advantage, and is a big advantage, and we are seriously looking at using that method for manufacturing aero engine components. But clearly it's not mass production. Not mass production, as I think you were implying.
Well, I meant more things that, rather than being customised components, things which are a standard design that you would produce multiple.
Well, in that case, yes, that would be an application, definitely. Yeah. And it saves a great deal of time and cost compared with the conventional methods such as casting.
So there is a big market, profitable market, for ceramics which are 3D printed. Okay, and that is where you can sell things which do not require actually structural integrity. So for example, in a chess set, you have a castle with internal staircases and everything 3D printed. You can see this movie on my website. That actually sells and makes profit. So we are just thinking here of engineering components, but there's a lot of aesthetic appeal in having a castle which has internal structure which you can see.
Yeah.
I mean, if you drop this castle on the floor, it might it's shatter.
It's not that bad, actually. But it doesn't require to be stressed externally.
No.